Good morning, students. Today we will be studying nomenclature. While classifying animals, it is important to identify the animal. And when we identify an animal, means we are giving the animal its name. So what is nomenclature? This is a system through which organisms, including plants, animals, microorganisms, and all other living things, are given a distinct scientific name. Each group of organisms, whether they are plants or animals, they are classified under special divisions according to their similarities and features. Therefore, all the living organisms should also have a common naming system that makes it easier to understand them better. Why is the need for a scientific name? We see that common names are not authentic, but these names are changed from language to language and from area to area and also from country to country. For example, the common house sparrow, it is called so in England, but in India we call it Goraya, in Spain we call it Pardal, and in Japan they call it Susan. Similarly, some common names for different animals are the same. For example, Quechua, Ascaris, and Earthworm, both are known by this common name. Then there is no procedure which is followed for common names. For example, we may take a superficial character for naming the animal. In the case of blackbird, since it is black, we call it blackbird. Then it is a habit of a particular animal by which we can give a common name. For example, if the fish is flying, it is a flying fish. Similarly, a habitat where the particular animal is staying, tree frog. If the frog is staying on tree, we call it a tree frog. And similarly, it is the usefulness of that particular animal. In an oyster, if a pearl is formed, we call it pearl oyster. Then common names are often very misleading. For example, here we can see the name of a few animals: starfish, silverfish, cuttlefish, jellyfish, crayfish, and dogfish. Out of these, starfish is from phylum Echinodermata, silverfish is phylum Arthropoda, it belongs to class Insecta, cuttlefish belongs to phylum Mollusca, jellyfish belongs to phylum Coelenterata, and crayfish belongs again to phylum Arthropoda and class Crustacea. All these animals are invertebrates, but their common names are belonging to a fish, like starfish, silverfish, cuttlefish, jellyfish, and crayfish. Now, dogfish is the only fish here. It belongs to the phylum Pisces and it is the only vertebrate here. So these common names are often misleading. A common system of naming is therefore essential so that it makes it widely acceptable throughout the world. Therefore, there evolved a system called the binomial nomenclature, which helped to a great extent in maintaining and standardization in naming living organisms. Nomenclature. The word is derived from two Latin words, nomen, which means name, and clear, which means to call. Literally, it means to call by a name. This is defined as the system which is responsible for giving name to an organism. Binomial nomenclature. As we can see, bi means two, nomial means name, and nomenclature means the system of naming. So in this system, organisms are given scientific names and the names consist of two parts, as we are saying, binomial, two names. The first name indicates genus and the second part indicates the species. Who introduced this binomial nomenclature? Carl Linnaeus was the one who formalized the binomial nomenclature as the modern system of naming organisms. Therefore, it is also known as the Linnaeus system of classification. He designed this system so as to differentiate species from one to the other. In his book Systema Naturae, in 1758, he described and classified thousands of species of plants and animals. He is also regarded as the founder of modern taxonomy. The system and rules of binomial nomenclature. These rules are given by International Code of Zoological Nomenclature. It is a standard set of rules which is applicable to plants and animals both while giving them unique names within a given system. According to this system, each organism is known by two names. The first name is a simple noun which represents the genus. The second name is a descriptive adjective which denotes the species name. These names are all written in Latin because Latin is a dead language. The name of the genus always begins with a capital letter since it is a noun. The species name begins with a small letter. The generic and specific name cannot be the same. But there are a few exceptions to this. For example, the genus and the species are the same in case of Rattus rattus, the black rat, and Vulpes vulpes. These are allowed under the ICZN, that is the International Code for Zoological Nomenclature, but are prohibited in the current edition of ICN, the Melbourne Code published in 2011. No two generic names in the kingdom can be the same. Similarly, the scientific names are always written in italics in print, and when handwritten, the genus name and the species name have to be underlined separately. That is, the genus is underlined separately and the species name is underlined separately. A few examples of the names of organisms written in this system are, example are Homo sapiens, Panthera tigris. So these are written in italics, the genus name and the specific name. If they were handwritten, both of them would have been underlined separately. The line cannot be a continuous line. The name or the abbreviated name of the scientist describing the species for the first time should be written after binomial name. Example, Homo sapiens linearis, and the year within the brackets, that is 1758. But the name of the author does not form part of the name of a taxon and its citation is optional, although it is customary and often advisable. If the name is revised, that is, if the name is changed, the name of the original describer should be written in the parentheses or the brackets followed by the name of the revising scientist. What are the essential requisites of the binomial nomenclature? These are three important requisites. Uniqueness, that means the scientific name should be unique and individualistic. It must be the only name within that nomenclature. Second is universality. Scientific name should be universal and acceptable throughout the world and biological society. Then it is third is stability. Scientific name should be stable and authentic and should not be changed over and over again. The scientific name is the key to information about a particular organism. Therefore, even the principle of priority can be set aside by the International Commission. Now we come to trinomial nomenclature. What is trinomial nomenclature? Tri means three. Nomial means naming. So the using three words for the name is called trinomial system of nomenclature. It consists of three words, that is genus, species and the subspecies. This nomenclature refers to the names for taxa below the rank of species. Some species, due to their different habits and habitat should show certain minor changes because of the difference in environment. This causes the development of subspecies. To differentiate these subspecies, the third name is given to such different races. For example, we can take the example of the house sparrow. Corvus splendens splendens is the name, scientific name given to the Indian crow. Corvus splendens insolens is the name given to the crow, house crow in Burma, and Corvus splendens protigatus in Sri Lanka. The subspecies name is written in small letter when it is handwritten, and it is italicized if it is in print. Now, what is uninomial nomenclature? The collective taxa are provided only with a single scientific name. For example, a single name for kingdom, a single name for phylum, a single name for class, for order, and for family. Example, phylum Arthropoda, class Insecta, order Orthoptera. So, in uninomial nomenclature, there is one scientific name. What are the advantages of the binomial nomenclature? These names are standard and precise and are accepted universally. It avoids confusion created by the vernacular or the local language. It indicates a phylogenetic history of that species. It helps to understand the relation between organisms and group of organisms. Thank you. With this, we understand how and why naming the animal is important, and the name should be a scientific name.